everyone. Welcome to another episode of the Food Origins Podcast. Today, my guest is the Alchemist Farm, which is a small family farm team headed up by Franchesca and Ryan Duval, along with their two children up in Northern California. Known for being pioneers of humane breeding and hatching, no male chicks are killed on their farm as they are at large-scale hatcheries, and all of their heritage breeding groups are free to roam on their separate pastures. Francesca was born and raised in Santa Cruz, California, of German, Greek, and Italian descent. Francesca's great-grandfather owned a German bakery in San Francisco. Francesca was studying to be a midwife and a psychologist before she had the opportunity to start her own project. After finding out male chicks are killed at large-scale hatcheries, Francesca and her husband Ryan decided to start hatching their own. Starting with six eggs and a small incubator, the start of Alchemist Farm began. Francesca shares her mass knowledge and experience on the podcast about her heritage breeds, the egg colors, feed for chickens, and answering many of your pressing common questions. Alchemist Farm raises their chickens for health, temperament, egg color, and climate resilience. Their birds are raised for hatching eggs and sending baby chicks all over the United States. The farm is also zero waste and using solar power to make a better impact on the world. Appreciate Francesca for sharing all her knowledge and being on the podcast. Enjoy this one. It was a lot of fun. If you guys are watching on YouTube, you'll be able to see some interesting surprises.
Sure, you're not in a gopher hole.
Yep. Unk. Got it on video.
You saw it here, folks.
Yeah. All right. We are rolling. I am here on location with Francesca Duval, the founder of Alchemist Farm, along with her husband Ryan, who's helping manage it while we're here. Mm-hmm. So hi everybody. And thanks for listening. And Francesca, thanks for being here. Thanks for having me here. I appreciate it. And you're known as the head chicken wrangler. Mm-hmm. You are the instructor also, teaching a lot of the classes for learning about chickens. And then pretty much you're the holistic manager for all of your flock. And then you're responsible for helping with all the shipping of all the chicks that go out to the world.
Customer service, all those kind of things.
Yeah.
I run our marketing. It's a lot.
Yeah. You got a lot going on. You know, my wife and I were following you for quite some time. And so she was like, this would be a really good podcast for pretty much everybody that wants to know about chickens. And this one, you know, if you've always wanted to hear different details, and those of you that have chickens at home, you're going to get a lot of insight as well. So appreciate you coming on. And why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself? Tell us where you're from. Give us your background. All that good stuff.
I was born and raised in Santa Cruz, California. So now I'm in Sebastopol. Haven't gotten that far away because California is just pretty sweet, this area where we are. I love being in Sonoma County here because it's a hub of good, clean food. And there's this incredible marriage of keeping chickens and knowing our food sources that I'm really excited to get into today. So for all of you who are like, why are we talking about chickens on this like amazing food podcast? It's because there's a lot of nitty gritty amazing things there. So chickens have always been part of my life, and I had no idea that I was going to be doing this with my life in particular. I was studying to be a midwife and was attending live births, have a degree in psychology, but one thing led to another, and I was presented with this opportunity to start my own project when I found out what large-scale hatcheries did with their male chicks. I was going to order chicks for our farm here, and then when I discovered that they kill all the extra male chicks that no one wants to order upon hatch, it just hurt my heart so much. And it was this lightning bulb moment of, I gotta do something better. I cannot support that. So I started hatching for myself, and one thing led to another. And now we've got 13 breeds on our acreage here and hatch out, you know, a bunch of baby chicks each week and ship nationwide. It's a pretty full on project.
Awesome. Just that real quick. And, you know, so you said growing up in Santa Cruz. So what was that like? And, you know, what was some of the things you ate as a child?
I love this question. Like, what did you eat? What's your relationship with food? So, I mean, really clean eating in Santa Cruz.
Yeah.
But when I was growing up, knowing our food sources wasn't a priority in my household. So my mom did the best she could with what she had. I know she tried to give us the best, but culturally from our generations of our family, like we came from like that wartime, like food from a can, Jello, like fast, easy meals that were like so popularized, kind of right. getting people away from their clean food sources. And so that's what was presented to me. I think also in the dynamic of those generations of my mother's side of the family, there was this almost like food is something that needs to be conquered for body image. Like you don't eat for pleasure. Mm-hmm. And so now I think that's why I'm so passionate about what I do now, because I want to know what is the cleanest food? What is the most nourishing food? What can I present my family with that's going to be healthy for them? Because there's such a direct correlation between how we eat and how we feel, depression, anxiety, all of these things that can be cured with just healthy eating. So growing up, I wasn't presented with this kind of lifestyle at all. And I think that's why I'm like all in on it and love to talk about it with people and get them inspired, because there's a whole world of amazing food out there. You can eat for pleasure and have it be healthy. Yeah. It's not like you have to have one or the other.
Yeah. And that's awesome. I mean, I think I'm in the same boat. You know, you grew up with slow food for the most part, if your parents were good cooks. And so a lot of, you know, different things that were cooked took longer to cook. And then later you're growing up and going to school and, oh, you know, we got to cook it in 5 minutes or 10 minutes, trying to have these quick meals. And then that's when, you know, kind of the marketing came in where everything's got to be quick and fast. And we know that all that stuff's not good for you. So it's really neat for you to have that. And I think it's a question you wanted me to ask you before we talk about it. What was your first impact with food and what was that like? And, you know, what was that kind of started your journey?
When I first tasted that healthy food could be delicious, it was like this revelation, which seems so obvious now, but at the time there was always like, I don't really want to eat that carrot, because I was being presented with stuff that was a couple weeks old and had been trucked from really far away. We didn't know our farmers, and so it just wasn't delicious. But now knowing that delicious food can be healthy food was huge. So that was the light bulb moment for me.
Yeah. Was it a particular dish, or was it carrots, or just some mashed up stuff?
It was homemade chocolate.
Oh, okay.
It was making my own chocolate, and I had a little like side chocolate business for a different while. I've tried a few different things on, and okay. So it was that, like doing like a raw vegan chocolate and having wow. that be like something that was really delicious, and then kind of going down the road of like, oh, it's like, do I want to be a raw foodist or all these other things? Like I need these extreme things that actually didn't serve my body. I had to try and find the right, like, what is it that helps me feel nourished? And through running the farm, like the farm has been such an incredible guide and ally of knowing myself, knowing my stressors, knowing my food. In 2020, when everything was happening with the pandemic, it was like, you know, the world shut down. We were all dealing with a lot of stressors. It was intense. But the world of chickens did not shut down. People were home and they wanted chickens so bad. So our business exploded by like fourfold, which for a small family farm was a really big deal. Financially, it was amazing, but to rise to that occasion of to like get that workload was crazy. And so I was really pushing my body through a lot and having like 3 hours of sleep, lots of coffee, not eating very well. And then 2021, 2022, I had all of these health issues pop up where I was like, whoa, like, am I like seriously ill? I would get like blood draws, CT scans, all these things. I'm like, there is something wrong with me. Mm. Finally, I sat in front of a naturopath and she's like, it's just chronic stress. It's the fight or flight response and it's your diet. Let's dial all of it in and get you back to yourself. And I feel 100% today, you know, 2023, knowing the power of clean food and paying attention to our stressors. So the farm has given me so much and shown me so much in that. And that's why I love to talk about clean food, because a lot of us feel like something's wrong, and it is, because we're malnourished, you know?
Yeah. And what is your background, like your ethnicity and then some of your training, you know, some of the things that you're educating yourself with, and before we get into how you started the farm, how did that come about?
My ethnicity, so my dad's side, it's German and Greek, and they actually, my great-grandfather owned a German bakery in San Francisco. He developed the Girl Scout cookie.
Oh, wow.
Cool, okay. Culinary fact.
Yeah.
And then my mom's side is like heavy Italian and Spanish and a little Greek too. So I wish that I had had more cultural dishes growing up. But again, like I said, it was just like the fast food McDonald's thing. It's just what was presented. Like, I think my mom just trying to like do the best she could.
Yeah. And sometimes it's just trying to get something fast, or it's something super simple. And I mean,
parenting's hard, man. Like, straight up. Like, that's right. I got no judgment. She did the best she could.
Yes. Yes. And then, so, and then as far as like, some of your, what you thought you were going to do, and then what led you to opening the Alchemist Farm. So like, tell us all how that happened.
So I was studying psychology. I love people. I love understanding relationship of environment and interpersonal relationships. I'm just curious about human beings. So I thought that I would be some sort of a one-on-one counselor, very empathetic, but I always loved animals at the same time. And I was like, oh, I can't be a veterinarian. Like, that'd be too hard for me. Like, guiding animals through death. Joke's on me, because I do a lot of that here on the farm too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is really powerful and important.
Yeah. You were just posting about that the other day.
I was. Yeah. We can get into that too, if that feels worthy of our time.
Sure.
So I was studying psychology, and then I thought, oh, I want to do something with like sex education and like empowering people to know that part of themselves, because I have an ability to make people feel comfortable, you know? And then I ended up doing doula work, and I was like, oh, it's in the birth field. I want to do birth work. And I was on track to be a midwife, and I was apprenticing births and going to home births. And then I realized there is no way that I could actually have a family and be a midwife, a wife to other families. So I made that choice, which was really hard. I'm like, oh, I cannot have this career if I want to have a family. I knew I wanted to have a family. Mm-hmm. So looked for something else. And that's when, that same week, I was ordering chickens for this land that we had just gotten. Like, when we bought this land, there was no intention of it being a chicken farm at all. My husband and I just love to homestead and grow our own food. Like, I always joke, like, when he said, like, I do to me when he married me, he had no idea. He was signing up for this life, but it works for us.
Yeah. Well, Liz knows that we're heading that way too.
Mm-hmm. It's a slow roll, but it's a good life.
For sure. We're starting to understand that even more and more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That marriage of the land, it brings us back, brings us present, makes us grounded. It's a profound gift.
Yeah. A huge connection to everything around you.
Yes.
And so got the land. Ordered some chickens.
Almost ordered chickens. And then found out that fact about the male chicks being killed. And I was like, oh, I cannot support that. That just, how can I have chickens in my life but not support that particular practice? And so I started hatching for myself. And then when I started hatching for myself with like this little incubator that had 6 eggs in my bathroom, and I wanted to get some fun, fancy chickens. So the hatching eggs were a present, a Christmas present for my dad and sister. That's how the whole farm started.
Wow. Like,
in my bathroom.
How many? Just 2?
It was 6 eggs.
6.
In this
little
incubator. And the process of watching them hatch, ladies and gentlemen, if you have never seen a chicken hatch, it's an incredible process to see. I had so much more profound respect for what these birds were, because I knew that they were important, but not to the degree at all that I understand now. Of people just view chickens like it's produce, almost like they're just this unintelligent thing that we eat.
Yeah.
They are so smart. They work so hard to come out of that egg and come out into the world and then stand up and fluff up, and they're just ready to go. I was blown away getting to see that. And then my life was just never the same, you know?
Yeah.
I've got 2 human children, and then I joke lots of other like feather children. And I really have that love for this particular animal. They give us so much for so little in return.
Of about approximately 13 varieties.
Yes, 13 varieties.
Maybe more. I thought I saw 14, but yeah, we'll get into those. And then that's what started it all, huh?
Yep, that moment of that realization. And then one thing led to another, where I was like, oh, there's actually like birds that lay this color. What? And then I just went down the path of like, well, I want birds that lay that, or I want birds that lay like green eggs with speckles. This looks like a dinosaur egg. It got me really excited. And then I knew, if I'm excited about this, there's got to be other people who are excited to do this. And there was really not a lot of people 10 years ago doing it at our scale. Since then, there's tons of little hatcheries that have popped up. I think we've really forged a like pioneer path for other people to see that what's possible. But
I think that's something that everyone wants to know, is these eggs aren't white.
Yes. So having colored eggs, the farm on one level is just the chicken farm. You know, that's like one thing we do. We like sell chickens, baby chicks, ship them nationwide. But on the other side of it, peel it back a layer, and we love educating on right ecological practices and how we can treat the natural world better. And one way we can do that is asking the question of, why aren't these eggs just white and brown? It's because there's a whole world of biodiversity of breeds out there. All these heritage birds that don't lay as many eggs as like the pearl leghorn, which is the commercial breed that lays the white eggs, but they're going to lay like maybe one less a week or two less a week. They're going to live a lot longer and they're giving you all of this incredible color. You know, it's like eating one type of tomato from the store versus like the thousands of different types with different varieties that have different flavors. There's this whole world of delicious tasting things. So why aren't these just white and brown? Because there's an incredible assortment of breeds that lay all sorts of things. And it gets people to ask that question of why aren't I seeing these? Mm-hmm. Oh, it's because of how those birds are raised, what kind of breeds those are, what is the actual life for those birds? How are they treated? It's a gentle gateway to have those conversations that are actually pretty hard because per capita chickens are the most abused animal in the world.
Yeah, there's so much in production and money in it, and getting back to kind of like what we've been talking about with, and we were talking earlier about regenerative farming and, you know, working off the land and not involving any of this chemical interaction or any additional stuff. And so like, and of course everyone's going to ask you, but is it the varying colors, is that based on diet and the breed, or is it a combination?
100% the breed. And within the breed, okay, there can be some dietary things that can shift.
Okay.
But what I'm, as a breeder, what I'm breeding and selecting for is more saturation of color.
Okay.
You know, a breeder of any kind of animal can choose whatever they want. There is this whole like association, the APA standard of like the SOP for chickens, where they have to look a certain way. It's kind of new to have like, hey, I'm just breeding for fun colors because that's what's fun to me.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of breeder I am. These guys, their color, you can see, you can actually rub it off with a cloth or you can kind of scratch it off. Mm. Theirs is like a heavy bloom that goes over the top. So that color is laid over the egg as the egg's actually coming out. A blue, it's saturated inside the shell. You can't actually rub it off. And then some of these, like this is also a Moran's egg, same as these, but it has a really heavy bloom over it that's extra powdery. So from afar, it almost looks like a purple egg, which is super fun. Yeah, and
it almost looks like a quick spray of purple.
That's a good way to put it. The bloom is like a spray.
Yeah.
It's an antimicrobial layer that's put over the eggs that protects it from bacteria. So you could leave these out on your countertop unrefrigerated for quite some time.
About how long?
People always ask me that question, and it depends on each person's house. If there's really large temperature swings, they're not going to be good as long. But way back in the day before refrigeration, farmers would store clean eggs, unsoiled, without any kind of feces on them, in straw in their cellars, in their root cellars, and that would get them through the winter because chickens don't naturally lay in the late fall winter. This is a new, like, industrialized thing since we put lights on them in warehouses. I think that's why eggnog is such a, like, amazing thing in the winter and culturally, like, a really big treat, because eggs were scarce in the winter, and then having like a rich fatty thing helped people stay warm, put some fat on them in the winter. So how long can they stay? It depends on how temperature regulated your house
where
is.
They're stored. Okay.
And the good news about an egg is if it's questionable, you can always crack into a separate bowl or cup and you'll know right away if it's bad. It's like spoiled milk, you know.
Okay.
If you look at it and you're like, that looks funky, don't eat it.
And then I'll ask the question about the yolk. The yolk should look like this, kind of, right?
It can, yeah. So that can be influenced by diet.
I'm referring to the dark orange, if you guys are listening, but
this is so you can achieve that, but not with regular feed. Some people will feed their chickens different peppers. Chickens can't, they don't have the receptors in their tongue to feel heat, so they can eat peppers, and it's actually really good for their body, for any kind of like microbes or worms or things like that, to clean them out. But to get that color, you'd have to be feeding them like dark, dark red peppers, and then it translates.
You can
get like a few shades lighter than that from them eating grubs, bugs, and being outside.
Yeah, and that's my next question for you is, what typically do you feed your chickens? That was also what I was getting into. Like, what are some of the chicken scraps? And I have a friend that feeds them peppers, and you were just getting into that. So, yeah, what do you feed your heritage breed?
So, for a healthy yolk, we like to do a really varied diet. And varied diet, it's just like humans. Like, we need so many different types of foods to have a healthy microbiome. Same with the chickens. It's kind of funny that the nutrition facts on an egg, if you look at it in the store, are all the same, because eggs are not laid equal at all. Like an egg that has been laid by a hen in a warehouse who's just getting a certain type of grain is totally missing all of the nutrients that an egg laid by a chicken that's on pasture, getting grass, grubs, all sorts of different bugs, and then food scraps has. So we are a zero waste farm here. All of our kitchen scraps that we can feed the chickens, we do. Things we don't feed them would be coffee grounds, chocolate, bone, banana peels, citrus. You're not supposed to.
Avocado pit too, I think.
But yeah. Who's eating an avocado pit?
Yeah, I know.
It's one of those things where it's like, and citrus peels, it's like, yes, that's toxic to them. But what chicken's going to sit there? Like, it would have to be a very unintelligent chicken. And chickens aren't. They're smart. They're going to take a bite of that and be like, no thanks. So even though if it's toxic, they're not going to eat enough to actually hurt themselves.
Yeah.
So those kind of things go into our regular compost pile. But our chickens get all of our kitchen scraps. And straight up, there is so much waste. We are diverting from the waste stream by doing that. If everyone had that in their kitchen, we would cut so many greenhouse gases. So that's a benefit of having chickens. It's a great ecological thing. We're feeding the pasture, food scraps, and then we feed grain from Hunt and Barons in Petaluma. They have a grain mill on site. And then they just have a really balanced mix. And our birds are healthy. They don't molt very often. They're in really good shape from that particular mix. So whatever they can't pick up from the pastures, or right now as we get into the heat of summer, a lot of the pastures go brown. That's when they're getting more grain.
Okay. And then that grain feed is just a blend that they make?
Yep. Yep. Super balanced of all. You know, you could get soy-free, you can get corn-free, you can get organic, not, whatever, wherever you fall on the spectrum, they have it there. I don't think they ship, so it's definitely like space-dependent here on Northern California. But okay. I've heard other people have good luck with Modesto Mills. It is an all-organic feed. Sometimes you have to be careful because there's not the right minerals and vitamins in it, because it's hard to get those organic.
Okay. Awesome. Are they herbivores?
No.
Yeah.
They're omnivores.
Yeah.
Yeah. They will eat meat. They'll eat chicken. So don't feed them chicken, but they will. They can't tell. So
yeah.
I don't want to feed that to them because that's kind of strange.
It is kind of strange.
Any leftover beef? Oh my gosh. Yeah. They're all about it.
Okay.
Fat. I love giving them coconut milk and different coconut cream or coconut oil during the winter to give their feathers a good shine. Give them some extra layers of warmth.
And then, why do you call them heritage breed? Like, what's the difference? What's a non-heritage and heritage?
Older. So it's okay. A breed that's been more established.
Okay.
Something that is not in big factory production, something that's worth protecting. We're really conscious of why we selected the 13 breeds we work with. We believe there's a breed for everybody. We're breeding for temperament. Health is our number one thing we're breeding for, making sure that we're putting healthy birds out into the world that don't have any kind of inbreeding issues, that are robust. We breed for resilience to all sorts of different diseases here. We don't vaccinate here. That's a controversial thing. Some people only want their birds vaccinated, but we don't use antibiotics or vaccines because we want our birds to be able to meet the challenges of an environment themselves. So we're breeding for health first, temperament second, egg color third, climate resilience fourth, because we're seeing extreme swings. Like here we are in early July and it's cold.
Yeah, we were going for the golden hour and we got it though. I think good lighting,
it's good lighting,
it works out. And yeah, and that's something that I think that you kind of press on with the way you raise your chickens is by temperament, keeping them calm, cool, and chill, right?
Yeah, most of our customers are like first-time chicken keepers who have a small backyard, who have little kids. I have little children. You know, we have a lot of roosters here, and our chicken children can go up to any of the roosters and bend over, turn their back to them without any kind of fear of being attacked. And many people have horror stories of getting attacked by roosters, and they're actually dangerous. They can do a lot of damage, especially to a young child. When we did get a group of chickens from a hatchery before I had the revelation that we shouldn't order from large hatcheries anymore, they gave us a free bird and it was a rooster. And that rooster attacked my daughter and got her in the head and like pecked a hole like part of her scalp. It was so traumatic. And I thought, man, I can never put someone else's family through that. So that's why only nice guys get to breed and mean ones go to freezer camp.
And what is a good breed for a beginner?
Any of the breeds that we have on the website are going to be really good for first-time chicken keepers because we're selecting for temperament. So you can look and decide, like, oh, do you want a chicken that lays a green egg or the brown egg with speckles or the dark-colored egg? Space is a consideration. We have really, you know, small breeds. Like, this breed is not going to be the same as, like, that bird. You can tell because of just the egg size that they have. But so I always ask people, what's your space like? And what kind of relationship do you want to have with the birds? Are they pets? Are they just for egg production? Are you going to be seeing them every day? Or are they out in the field somewhere? And that helps guide what kind of breeds I push them towards.
Yeah. So if someone's like in a big city and they're allowed chickens, you know, what do you suggest they kind of try to set up?
The smaller breeds. For okay. sure.
Yeah.
So that would be our double silver lace Barnevelders. They lay, you know, the smaller breeds, they don't lay like the really crazy colors. So it just depends if people are okay with that. But this bird in particular, you were commenting on before, it's that black bird with the white lacing. They are gorgeous.
Yeah. They're so cool looking.
And really sweet birds. Like, soup, the temperament's lovely. Them or our Bantam Cochins are really cute and they look like little feather dusters. I have one I could show people if you guys want to see.
Yes, we do. But since we got video. Sorry, if you're listening on audio, you're going to have to watch this on YouTube later.
This bird.
Francesca's blessing us with some birds. Ooh.
It's feeling feisty.
Oh, wow.
So this is the breed I was just talking about, the Bantam Cochin.
Beautiful.
So she's small, you know.
Yeah.
So if you're in a city setting, you could have a few of these girls, no problem. She is broody. That's why she was able to just go in the box really easily today.
Explain that.
A broody hen is a hen that wants to be a mother. And so she has been sitting on the nest waiting for her eggs to hatch. During the summer months, we do not let the chickens sit on their eggs for 21 days. It takes 21 days like clockwork from an egg to be laid to an egg to be hatched if a chicken was sitting on it. But we don't let them sit on their own eggs because it gets so hot. And during the time when they're broody, they don't eat or drink, which is so sad. So what I do is I wait for them to be broody for at least 3 days and I give them baby chicks. I slip little baby chicks under them at night and then take out any eggs they were sitting on so they wake up thinking that they hatched their own eggs.
Oh.
And then they're just bonded.
Slick. Yeah.
So she's due for that in a couple of days, but I thought I'd pull her out to show you. So for people living in a city, she's small, you know?
Yeah.
And then even smaller than this are our ceramas. And the ceramas are, you know, no bigger than this would be a big cerama this tall. They're very small.
Yeah, they're pretty much the smallest chicken, right?
They are.
In the world? Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, some people have house chickens in the city, too. They put diapers on them, and they like, sit there and watch Netflix and give them popcorn. It's a totally different relationship. I know you have a face.
Yeah.
It's not the relationship I have with my birds, but for some people, like, that's a therapy animal.
Yeah, yeah.
We've had a lot of birds go to senior centers, elderly care facilities, and it's so healing for people, especially people with dementia, to go out to the same coop and, like, collect the same egg, you know, over and over. It gives them joy. It gives them something to do. They're up and moving. Or people who are stuck in their beds, they put a chicken on their lap, a little diaper on it, and it's clean, and it just sits there and clucks at them.
Yeah.
It's really sweet.
Provides some comfort.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is the cerama egg, right?
Yep.
This little guy?
Yep. So the cochin egg would be between this size and this size.
Okay. And how old?
She's a year.
She's a year.
So she's a fully grown bird.
Okay.
No, she's small.
Yeah.
The rest of our breeds are about double this size.
Okay.
Just for size reference for people.
Yeah.
And like how many you could have in a city.
Beautiful.
Put her back in the box.
Bro. Yeah.
A little show and tell.
Yeah, I love it.
And I jumped to broody hen question.
Yeah, no, that's good. We kind of, you know, we're getting into a lot of that stuff. And then just to touch on the, you know, having a small space. Would they just start at least two, right?
Always. They're very social creatures. A single bird, people do it, but it would have to be like a perch chicken. You'd always have to have it with you.
Yeah.
And if you don't always have them with you, it's cruel. They can't just be alone.
Yeah, they need a buddy.
They need a buddy. Now, if something happens and one bird dies, it's okay. You can, you know, wait a week or two before you find a replacement. Mm-hmm. In that case, I like to put a mirror in the space, a feather duster, so they feel like they have a buddy and they can cuddle up.
Interesting. Do you think they should start with more than two?
Chicken math is real.
Yeah. Okay.
So this depends on the breeds people choose too. If they order from us, not all baby chicks are guaranteed female. Some are something called straight run, where it's a 50-50 chance male or female. So if they know that they want to end up with three hens, but they're choosing different breeds that are straight run, they should get six chicks, because that's, you know, the odds.
Got it. Got it. That's really cool. Then some of the issues that you might have raising them, we were talking about mites. How do you deal with mites?
So mites, they can come in on straw, different kind of bedding and substrate for the coops. They can come in from wild birds. There's a couple different types. And you don't want them to get out of control, because they will live in every single crack and crevice of the coop. And then they get all over the chickens. They're not harmful to humans. They're just kind of gross crawling on us, but they do bite the chickens and suck the blood. Mm. And so too many mites can cause issues of the chickens just being so run down, because they're just going to be low in iron. So there's a couple of different treatments. Some people will scrub out the coop, bleach it, and put things like diatomaceous earth down. I've had really good luck with a spray called Elector PSP. It's the only thing that I spray on this farm. And okay. It doesn't have any kind of egg withdrawal time. A lot of chicken sprays are pretty toxic, and you wouldn't want, you know, it's toxic for the birds, it's toxic for the soil, and then there's a time where you don't want to even eat the eggs after it's been sprayed on the birds. So it's pretty intense.
Yeah.
So Elector PSP is not that way.
Okay. We'll put all that good stuff in the show notes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure if you guys haven't been to alchemistfarm.com, Franchesca has really given you a super detailed explanation of a lot of these things. She has her frequently asked questions. Also, explaining all the breeds. We'll get into talking about some of the names of them, and then what they're capable of and what they offer, and then of course what kind and how their temperament is. Mm-hmm. Most of yours are easygoing, which is awesome. And then, but you get into the colors of the eggs. There's a condition that some of the chickens come up with. It's called bumblefoot.
Yes.
Could you explain that? You know, coming from, I'm a city boy, didn't really have chickens growing up, but you know, now my friends are having chickens all over the place. So tell us, you know, that condition and what it is and how do you take care of it?
Like a thorn or a splinter or some kind of foreign object in the foot of a chicken. So if we had it in our foot, what would we do to treat a splinter? We'd take it out, or we'd soak our foot first and then try and pull the foreign object out. It's the same for the chickens. So you'll know that a chicken has it if it's limping, or if it's keeping one foot up and kind of hopping around, or if the foot looks really large. People can get it from having, or chickens can get it from having blackberries in the yard, or if the roosting bars have any kind of splinters inside the coop. I favor using dowels. Some people use branches, which are good, but if it's older wood, sometimes it's splintered, so you want to sand it down. Because as they sit there in the night, they're kind of rocking with their feet to hold themselves up, so yeah. That's how they can get it. But you soak the foot and you look for the foreign object, take it out, and then you can just give them like an Epsom salt foot bath to try and heal it. Some people bandage the foot up and do that.
Is there a solution before that? Do you have to, or just soaking it in water and just letting it soften up?
So if you can find the object before softening it, then go for it.
Yeah.
But sometimes it's hard to see. Chickens are actually really amenable to this kind of veterinary care, like especially if you're giving them a bath and holding them and giving them some mealworm treats. Yeah. They're totally down.
Okay.
If for whatever reason a person has a little more of an unreasonable hen, this can happen from time to time. I do all my veterinary care at night because they're asleep and okay. They're just kind of like, whatever, touch my
super
foot.
Chill.
Super chill at night.
Yeah.
Yes. Any kind of vet checks I always do at night, or trimming of the wings, things like that, always done at night.
Yeah. I think that's a good inside tip right there too. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, chickens run just fast enough to make us look ridiculous.
Yeah.
And they don't sweat, so you actually don't want to chase them around a lot. They can have heart attacks if we chase them too much, you know.
Oh, that's something else that you talk about, yeah.
Yeah, people just don't think about it, you know. Mm. Like, it's fun to chase the chickens around. It's okay for a little bit, but if it's constantly, you know, if a neighbor dog gets in and chases the chickens around, it can actually be pretty detrimental to them because they can't cool themselves down. So veterinary care at night is always best because they just don't care, and then you're not having to chase them and look ridiculous in the process.
And then when do the chickens lay the most eggs, and what's the average?
That's spring chicken, you know, they're a spring chicken phase. So yeah. In the spring, average egg production is totally based on breed.
Yeah.
And if they need at least 14 hours of natural daylight to start laying. So they can start laying in the winter if they become 5.5-ish, 6-ish months in the winter, but they won't be laying full steam. as they will in the spring. So around that age of 5.5 months is when they're going to start laying, and then at least 14 hours of daylight. So some people achieve this by putting supplemental light in the coops. If you are going to do that, I recommend doing it in the middle of the night. I recommend doing it at the end of the night. It's a little bit harder for them to be able to get into the coop, and you have to train them a little more, but then they just kind of like stay awake, and then the light goes off, and then they wake up to having natural dawn, as opposed to like randomly the light pops on at like 4 a.m. and they're it's aggravating to their system. If you stack too many stressors, then that can affect their health. Same as humans.
Just taking them out of their rhythm. Circadian rhythm.
They need it too.
Yeah.
Because then they're going to be laying more eggs and be healthier in the long run for people.
And then what's the average, like, if, I wouldn't say like, you know, it's at high production, but just normal production a week?
Five eggs. Spring, summer, and then leading into fall, it'll taper off. But any of our breeds will hit that.
Okay.
Which honestly, that's plenty.
Yeah.
You know, like the pearl leghorn, they'll lay 7 to 9 eggs a week. That's the industrial birds that lay the white egg. Mm. Like the battery cage chickens will do that, but they can only do it for a year. And then those flocks are turned over. All those birds are killed and then new ones come in. Mm. That's that cycle.
Yeah.
And people don't realize they're supporting that when they get like, you know, the $2.99 dozen of eggs from the grocery store. They just, especially when like the carton has like, you know, the picture of the pasture or like cage-free. Cage-free just means that they're in a warehouse and not in battery cages, which is, of course, one step better than battery cages, but they're never seeing the light of day. It's not right.
No. And there's a lot of like misconceptions of different descriptions.
For sure.
You know, because like some say they add stuff to it, they're adding vitamins. You know, like you were saying, like if it's fed right, it doesn't need, you know, the egg is going to have its full nutrient base, right?
Yeah. We're adding stuff because they're eating a pretty stripped down diet in this warehouse. Like that's a good tell, you know.
Yeah.
Even, you know, like pasture raised used to be the thing that you'd look for. And even that, it's like, it just could be chickens in a dirt field, which is okay. One step better.
Yeah.
But still, like regenerative is like the word that you can't really trademark any of these words. And it's like, how fast can the marketing machine of these like big ag companies compete with these words? So that's where knowing your farmer is everything.
Yeah.
With every food source, if farmers aren't willing to peel back their practices and really share what's going on, they have something to hide. That's why we have a really robust social media program, because I love educating on what we do and how we do it, because we don't give farm tours here, because we have to be careful of the biosecurity of all of our flocks. Like people can bring in all sorts of microbes on the bottom of their shoes and their hair that could potentially cause disease in our flocks. Avian influenza is a huge deal. And for the past 10 years, because we've been really careful about that lockdown of biosecurity, we've never had any issues. So we can't be showing our practices in person. So that's why we share so much over social media, so people can see and learn.
Yeah. And it's Alchemist Farm at Alchemist Farm on IG. And it's very extensive. You do, you know, some lives and you're showing details dealing with, you know, all the issues you have, but also just showing some freshly hatched chickens as well. Mm-hmm. So for everybody to see.
You guys want a serotonin boost? You want to see some baby chicks?
Yeah, for sure. Here we go, folks.
Prep some babies for everybody.
Oh, this will be awesome.
So these babies, what day is it? Thursday?
Yes.
Babies hatched 2 days ago.
Oh, wow. And what breed are these?
So this is the Bantam Cochin. This is the baby of the mama that you just saw. Oh.
What's up?
that Cochin's 2 days old. And this Cochin is 2 weeks old. Check out the little feather pattern.
Wow.
This is going to be a frizzle Cochin. You can tell because the little wings look like almost eyelashes. Isn't that cute?
Yeah.
And the size difference, you know, how quickly they grow.
Yeah.
These are the double silver lace Barnum elders. They're a black and white bird, and they kind of...
That's, I think, my favorite breed of what you have.
You're like, give me that one.
Yeah.
They like a warm hand.
Well, I was looking at all the different pictures you have on your website, and just the palette of color that it comes out with, you know, and I kind of related to some decorative tile or marble that's, it's just but it's symmetric.
It's like lace.
Yeah, it's like lace, and it's just dialed in like diamonds coming down the feathers. You know, it's gorgeous. Oh, you cold?
Yeah.
He's cold.
Whenever I teach children to hold chicks, I always say you make a cave, keep them warm, then they don't jump out.
There you go.
You can see on this chick, kind of fun fact, I don't know if you'll all be able to see it at home, but you see the end of the beak?
Mm-hmm.
It has a little extra white, kind of a lighter part. That's the egg tooth. It's a hard piece that actually helps the chick break out of the egg. It'll fall off after 3 days, so tomorrow we won't see it anymore.
And they, just certain ones end up having it stuck on there?
Yeah, that one, it probably fell off yesterday. This one still has it.
Okay.
But that's how you can tell the age of a chick too, which is pretty fun.
Awesome.
But such a serotonin boost looking at, you know, fresh babies coming into the world and getting to say hello to them. I think a lot about being that person because I sort all the hatches every week. You're still on. You're like, yeah, I want to keep holding. Yeah.
We'll get some B-roll on social media for those guys a little bit. That's awesome. And do you have a favorite breed?
If I could only have one breed for the rest of my life for some sad reason, it would probably be our Cerama. Mm-hmm. Because they're just so benevolent and small and comical, and they can't tear up the garden. You know, they're not a high egg production bird. They lay this size, so they're definitely not a practical breed.
Mm-hmm.
But if I could just only ever have one, it would be them.
Okay.
They're just so fun to see.
And I didn't see a Silky in there.
I know. We don't have Silkies this year.
Oh, okay.
We had a predator come through last year.
Oh, no.
And it totally messed with our breeding program. So that's the liability of farming how we farm here. Mm. We are completely unique in the hatchery world for a few reasons. One, we are totally vertically integrated. So all of the birds that we hatch are actually here on property. Other hatcheries, that's just too many. They used to hatch out tens of thousands of birds, you know? So they contract out with smaller farmers and then bring the eggs in. So we have all of the actual birds here and they're all out on pasture. There's no breeding cages or warehouses here. So that also means if there's any kind of issue with predation, it can happen. It's a risk we take and we lost with the Silkies.
Ugh.
But I feel like it's much better to give the birds the life that we're giving them as opposed to cloistering them up in a warehouse. So Silkies will be back soon.
Yeah.
But I love that you're really keying into the Silkies because it tells me a bit about your personality. I swear. People who are like extra machismo, like love Silkies.
Uh-oh.
It's like the guy, it's not a bad thing. It just means like you're really masculine, man. So people who...
All right, I'll take it.
Like lifted trucks, like they always are like, hey, do you guys have any extra Silkies?
I think they're just, I like them... You know, I don't even think of them that way. They're just funny. Like,
oh, yeah.
They just bring like that sense of charisma mm-hmm. to them, you know.
Small dog people like Silkies.
Yeah. Well, we have a small dog right now.
It's like chicken astrology. Like, tell me your favorite breed.
Yeah, I bet you can read people by what chickens they have.
It's that psychology background.
Yeah.
I love people, you know. It's like, I can't help but notice those patterns. So, Silkies are really comedic. The closest comedic thing we have here is the Bantam Cochins. When they run, their little butts are so fluffy. It's just, oh my gosh, so funny.
That's hilarious. And yeah, you've got quite the set of breeds. I mean, I can rattle most of them off, but you have your Alchemist Blue Line. So explain that one. That's kind of named after the farm. Is that just a blue chicken or is there, you know, you kind of tell us about that.
So we have heritage breeds that are like other breeders have cultivated over the years and we're continuing their lines and continuing to clean them up to have like specific beautiful egg colors. Like we did not develop the silver lace, the double silver lace Bonnevelders. We did not develop the heritage well summers or the Morans,
mm-hmm.
but we did develop these moss eggers for these interesting egg colors. We did develop the azure eggers and the alchemist blues because we wanted to breed for climate resilience for our area. Interesting egg color and that temperament. So we were taking the best of all these other breeds we were seeing and kind of adding like ingredients to the pot, if you will, to create something that in the end we were really pleased with. And the Alchemist Blues is one of those. It's like a thinner framed chicken, really high egg production, nice blue egg color, even keel temperament. They come in blue. They're called Alchemist Blue, but they also come in blue and black. And they're one of the few breeds that we can guarantee is female for people. So if they know they can't risk roosters, that's a really good one. But they're cute. And sometimes they have little mohawks.
Nice.
They look like little pump.
They've got a cool grayish, bluish kind of color going.
Kind of like a steely color.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love those birds.
Those are cool. Yeah, the Aziers. Mm-hmm. Azier eggers, they call them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's another one that you guys developed.
Yep. And it's another guaranteed female that lays a blue egg. So that's one that we put together. And, you know, some people would be like, oh, like, why would you differ from any of these other like breeds, and like what makes it heritage versus what makes it a new breed? It's just a matter of keeping that line consistent. And so, you know, we've been doing this for over 10 years with a lot of these breeds. So at what point does it become heritage? I don't know. Like they're name brands, if you will, that are out there.
Yeah.
So.
But I mean, you definitely have like a set of things that people look for, you know, in the protocol that you want. And so people are seeking out your chickens.
Yeah, for sure.
Where's the farthest place you've sent a chicken?
All corners. We do Hawaii. We do Alaska, New Hampshire. New Hampshire's probably the furthest, Maine.
Nice.
We don't ship internationally.
Yeah.
But no.
It's just too far, right? Too many.
I feel like it's just too many hoops, honestly.
Too many things going on. Yeah.
So many moving.
That's a long
parts.
Way to go.
It's a long way to go. We pack our birds for a 4-day potential journey, even though we select like overnight fastest express shipping. But the USPS is like this silent partner for us that we can't ship without them. It's the only legal way to be able to ship birds or hatching eggs over state lines. So we pack them for potential delays, but thankfully this year, knock on wood, they have all had very short journeys.
Nice. And you know, you mentioned that you're zero waste, and then you're also, I'm aware that you're fully solar here. So was that difficult, and how was that process of changing that completely over?
So in every business practice I have with the farm, it's all started from the heart and how I would want to be treated. It all started with that revelation of male chicks being killed. And then once I solved that problem, all of our male chicks are donated to folks who pick them up for food. So they raise them for food. It's not a perfect solution because in the end, they're still being eaten, but at least they're being given a life, and then they're helping support a family that otherwise might not have access to that kind of protein. So it's attacking a few problems at once. It's like a permaculture thing. It's stacking functions, you know, helping with food insecurity. And then we have these extra male chicks. What are we going to do with them? So once I got that solved, all these other problems presented themselves, problems, you know,
yeah,
which are actually opportunities for incredible change. And so whenever something feels overwhelming to me ecologically, then I know, oh, this is like a moment that's actually really rife for something positive to happen. I try and turn it around as opposed to feeling like overwhelmed by it. So I was paying attention to how much carbon it was taking for us to run the hatchery, how much power, because our incubators take a huge draw, the heat lamps to have the baby chicks, the shipping process has a carbon footprint to it. And so it was just really clear to me that I wanted to have solar panels, but the array is massive. We could take some pictures of it and put it in the show notes. And so it took quite a few years for us to be able to save up and do it, but that was what was really important to us. Like, we wanted every chick to be hatched by the sun. So we were saving up to do that as we were approaching different problems like plastic waste. Mm-hmm. Like, one day I looked at my trash can and was like, this is a lot of trash. And like, I'm wheeling it up to the curb and it's going away. But where is away, man?
Like, yeah,
this is too much. And so back in the day when people would ship hatching eggs, they would roll each individual hatching egg in bubble wrap plastic and then more plastic all around it so they would get to their destination ship safely. Or some people will use foam, like the inside of couches, which is like a total ecological nightmare. And I did it for a long time because it just wasn't presented to me as like, hey, this is a problem. And then one day that light bulb went off of like, that's a lot of trash. Like,
yeah,
what can I do as a business owner to change that? So now every single shipment of eggs is packaged in pine shavings. Like, we use the EcoFlake shavings that go into the brooders for our chicks. And so it's insulating them. It's protecting them from impact of like going down the conveyor belts that inevitably do with the post office. And it's completely biodegradable. Same with our chick shipments. Every single aspect of it could just be laid out flat in the garden after the chicks have been taken out, and it would just go back into the earth. It took a lot of effort to make that happen, but it feels like such a great gentle witness of what's possible, because the ecological problems we face on this planet are huge, and it can make any of us feel like overwhelmed, like we just want to stick our head in the sand. So my remedy for despair, what happens in the planet is positive action. And I know if I can do it in my business, I want to encourage everybody in whatever sector they are, restaurant, dentists, doctors of any kind, artists, to look at their waste stream and see what they can divert and see how they can make a better impact. Because there's actually a lot of low-hanging fruit and it feels so good to make that change. And P.S., customers want that. You know, it's not, I didn't do any of that for like green marketing or greenwashing. Like, I did it because it felt right. And I've got children and I want to leave them a habitable planet. But it just so happened that my customers were like, yes, I will go out of my way to support those practices. And with every shipment, we send a little note as to how to properly dispose of these things in a biodegradable way. And that gets wheels turning for other people. You know, we ship out thousands of boxes each year, and to be able to like just even plant that little seed for people in like Idaho, Alabama, Ohio, all these other places, we've gotten messages back of like, this changed my life looking at these things. And how humbling and amazing is that? Like, it, that that's the juice that makes me like be able to get up every morning and keep doing this work.
And that's like the next question is like, how do you stay focused? How do you stay motivated in the daily care of all your chickens and in the hatching? And how do you stay motivated and, you know, doing all the daily care?
By really listening to what's next and opening my heart to that. And knowing that whenever I'm speaking, even in this capacity, I'm not speaking from like my good ideas of like, okay, I should be telling these things and like doing this kind of marketing thing. But like, no, like there's a reason you and I are talking.
Yeah.
Someone's hearing this. It's going to trigger something for that person, whoever you are out there. Like, I hope that this touches your heart in a way and makes a light bulb go off for you of what you can change in your immediate area too, because it's so inspiring when you feel that, like, that you can make a positive impact. So that's what gets me up every day. And now I have some people helping me. I've got three people here on the farm. I was doing it all on my own through 2020 and 2021. And Ryan was here to help me, but I was really holding like the load of things because he was with the kids. And so I know now that for my my body and my ability and my stress levels, I need help. And so I ask for help and I've got three people that help me. So that's how I'm able to stay inspired every day and have these awesome conversations and listen for what's next, because there's other people helping me carry the load. It's definitely not me alone.
Awesome. And getting to, you know, we're going to close it out a little bit, but getting to any of the questions that you want to answer that are asked of you all the time that maybe, you know, that people want to hear. You have anything that gets asked of you every day, constantly, all day, every day?
Lots of questions about like what chicken lays what egg and things like that. Like, it's kind of like, you know, basic questions, which are still really good questions because it's a gateway, you know, what breeds would be good for me as a beginner, things like that.
Yeah.
And the things that I like to talk about are like, you know, how does your nervous system feel when you're near the animals? Or like, how is your heart when you're near the animals? Because you're actually, our hearts have this electromagnetic field that can go out like 6 feet, 3 feet on either side. Like, we are these beacons of energy and we can interface with the natural world, plants, animals, whatever, other humans, and heal each other. So sometimes people will ask me a basic question and then I noodle off into these other things because I'm like, I feel like this is actually more useful.
Yeah, for sure.
For humanity.
I mean, you answer a lot of them on your website anyway, because that way, you know, you can just divert that. But yeah, getting to the energy aspect, the therapy aspect for sure has been a big thing. Like, cooking is therapy for me, you know.
Mm.
You know, I like the joy of it. You know, for sure, cooking other people, cooking for myself, for my family and my wife. It's that, you know, that process. So I'm sure the process of all the things around you are therapeutic as well.
It's the gift of energy.
Yeah.
Like, you present a meal, it's the gift of your energy to other people. The baby chicks we send out, it's a encapsulated energy of this farm, of all these intentions, of all the hopes out into the world, little pieces of our heart just mailed all over the United States.
Yeah.
Hopefully people feel that too. Hopefully people feel the healing in your cooking, you know, what a gift you are.
Hmm. Anything we don't know that you think we should know about? Any additional information that's not out there that you think that's coming up or that comes up for you?
Just how incredible of an ally chickens are, an ecological ally to us, and they're really overlooked. from the food waste aspect of how we can divert so much from our waste streams to rotating pastures. A lot of people talk about, like, for large, big ag, rotating pastures with cows to be able to, you know, keep the fields actually more healthy. You can do so much in the world of regenerative agriculture with chickens, and it just hasn't really been done at a large scale yet. But that's something that I aim to try and educate about here and show at a smaller scale. You know, we're just under 4 acres here, but if we're able to do it here, I feel like it could be scaled up and created into something really beautiful at a large scale in other places of the United States to help with our soil, which is really depleted. So chickens invite us to get outside and be in one with the natural world, breathe fresh air, get away from our screens. You know, it's hard to get kids off a screen sometimes, but if they're out there daily egg collecting and learning basic veterinary care or care for animals, passing through their chickens, you know, they're just such incredible teachers. So a chicken is so much more than just a chicken. I feel like that's worth saying. They connect us to our food sources and are an incredible gateway to a whole different way of life. Even to gardening, you know, they give us so much compost from their droppings. Then suddenly, what do you have to do with it? Well, get some raised beds, and then suddenly you're gardening too, and you have your own fresh eggs and fresh vegetables. They create this gentle invitation.
Yeah, and then, you know, getting into, like you're saying, the passing. How do you deal with processing the chicken? You know, there's different ways, and there's a lot of manufacturing going on. Like, how do you? What is your? You know, what's the humane way of processing the chicken?
So we don't raise birds for meat here. We also don't raise birds for, like, table fare of eggs. Most of our eggs are turned into baby chicks, so we're a little unique in that. People assume, like, oh, you have a chicken farm, like, can I buy like 5 dozen eggs? It's not quite what we do.
A lot of people think about that when they hear, oh, you have a chicken farm.
Exactly, like they think meat or eggs. So we do neither. All of our birds are raised to then give us eggs for baby chicks. But if there ever is a baby chick that comes out and it has some sort of deformity where I know it's not going to have a life that's comfortable for it, it's not going to be able to get to food or water or things like that, I will humanely and swiftly put it down. And that never gets easy. It's totally gut-wrenching. But if I'm going to be bringing life into the world, I have to be responsible with helping usher it out if it needs help. So those are the times that I meet that aspect, that other side of the circle of life here.
Got it. Before we close it out, we got some fun questions too.
But
favorite tool, either in the kitchen or on the farm, that you just like, this thing helps me out every day, all day. You know, a lot of people like gear and stuff, so they want to know what's a great tool that you use.
Favorite piece of gear is this flat spatula. It's by D-O-I-B-O-I, Doi Boy. It's like a picture of a little bowl on it. I think it's from Italy.
Okay.
Black handle. I only cook in cast iron, and it is the perfect tool. It's like flat and sharp, and I use it for every single cooking. I take it camping with me. I should have brought it out here. I'll like send you a picture.
All right. We'll put it in the show notes.
That's
for
my
sure.
favorite tool. I love that
I
spatula.
Like it. I like it. And cast iron, definitely. I'm right there with you. I'm on cast iron pretty much every day.
Mm-hmm.
And it's,
I like the way it heats, the way it behaves. We don't have electric range. We only have a propane range, gas range. And so I really like knowing how that, how those tools are going to work for me, the cast iron. The
Favorite, getting into some of the local stuff that's around here. You mentioned a couple of the companies that provide you guys with feed.
Mm-hmm.
Anything, any, you know, favorite restaurants or favorite food that's around here?
Shout out to my favorite pizza place on south side of Sebastopol is Psychic Pie Pizza. It's a small family. They just had another baby. The pizza is so good. From my journey of trying to find the cleanest food and heal my own gut from the chronic stress and everything, I had to just find really clean, good food. And like, gluten was one of those things I couldn't eat for a long time, but I can eat their pizza because it's a sourdough crust that's fermented for 3 days. And oh, the toppings are all local. It's just so good. They have a miso peanut butter sesame cookie. That's like, are you kidding me?
Wow.
Massaged kale salad. I'm like, I'm a believer. No psychic pie. They're really good.
All right. There we go.
Recommend them. And then, for just like a general pantry food item, I love, love, love this company.
Oh.
Seen these guys?
No, I haven't.
Philosopher Foods. They're out of Santa Cruz, and they started their company the same year that we started ours. But I just encountered them this last year because I wasn't able to have any kind of refined sugar, and there's no sweetener in this particular almond butter, the creamy alchemy. I'm going to give this to you.
Oh, thank you.
This is like liquid gold, my friend.
Awesome.
It's just coconut oil and the sprouted almonds, and they're really big on only supporting almond farmers that are glyphosate free. Glyphosate is a huge, Roundup is a huge issue.
Yeah.
It's causing all of these health issues for humans. And it has been something that was touted as being safe for a long time, but now people are really realizing like, it's actually not that great.
Yeah. It's really become I hate to say it, but it's become a thing, you know, to look out for seed oils and different processing of different ingredients, not knowing that something's in there. And we're starting to, I've been diving into that a lot more, especially mm-hmm. talking to farmers and talking to other people and just, you know, cooking in general. And you kind of think you know what's in something, and then you look down in the ingredients and, oh, there's oil in this thing, or, you know, there's stuff that shouldn't be in there, basically.
Something you can't pronounce.
Yeah, something you can't pronounce, or a lot of it is the oil. I think there's a lot of stuff that has oil in it because they want to make it creamier, or they're adding this viscosity to it. So you look like, oh, it's been made, you know, it's super smooth, mm-hmm. but it's only smooth because they added some, you know, weird oil to it.
This is legit.
So if you guys are listening, she's got a jar of Philosopher Foods sprouted almond butter. It's their creamy alchemy version. How fitting.
I wrote to him and he's like, what? Alchemist Farm. Love it.
Awesome.
He calls himself the head alchemist, which is like,
there you go.
He's a brother from a
different
world.
That's perfect.
Part. But it's really nourishing, and something that I've noticed from different foods, like what actually is a whole food, what actually is a clean food. We have to eat less of it because our body actually is getting what it wants. And so this whole concept of like binge eating or almost or too much or any kind of special diet that you need to follow, all that goes to the wayside if you're just getting clean food, because you can eat as much of you want as you want of it, because your body will just self-regulate and know like what it's actually needing. And this is just so nutrient dense. I swear.
Beautiful.
It's my favorite thing.
Thank you for this.
And my favorite farmer in Sonoma County is Farmer George Macros from Earthworker Farm. He does microgreens, and you can catch him at the Sebastopol Farmers Market or different grocery stores around here, Andy's or Community Market. And he grows his microgreens in the soil, direct in the ground, and then harvests them the day of market, like 2 a.m. on a Sunday.
Nice.
To make them the freshest. And I swear his stuff is magic too. I eat that and I'm like, whoa, all my cells are just so happy. He's
nice.
Been at his craft for like 15 years.
Awesome. Maybe I'll have to chat with him.
He's really funny.
So awesome. And, you know, before we close it out, the floor is yours. Any advice, anything you want to promote, anything you got coming up, and anything you want to let us know?
I want to promote anybody who's listening to just follow their heart and whatever is really calling them right now, because I feel like a lot of us are waking up and being niggled by something in the universe to make those positive changes. Like, you can. If I can do it here, whatever business you're in, if you're a homemaker, whatever's going on with your home, you can make those changes and it's going to feel so good. I love interacting with people over our Instagram. It's like the main place that I would promote being able to access us. And our website, we hatch baby chicks and ship them nationwide from February through October every year. We also offer local pickup if you're within driving distance of the farms. That's a great way to support what we have going on, as well as pre-recorded online classes. So if you've never had chickens, we have a beginning chicken keeping class, or if you've had them and want to do more of a deep dive on veterinary care or hatching, we've got advanced chicken keeping. So all sorts of things for no matter where you are in your educational journey with the birds, we love supporting people.
Awesome. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Francesca, for being on. Appreciate all the info you're providing, and we'll get all the details in the show notes. You're at Alchemist Farm on Instagram and alchemistfarm.com.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Take care, everybody. We're out.
Bye.
And as a quick reminder, the restaurants and gear talked about on each episode can be found on my website, foodoriginspodcast.com. I appreciate your support, and thanks for listening.